What's up, guys? I am here doing this video for like the third time, and it's because I have changed my perspective on this case lots of times. I can't believe the further and the deeper I dive in and dig, I feel like the more I discover, the more my mind changes, the more different points of views I read into. And it's crazy because this case involves so many people, and it also was very much publicized in the media. There's a lot online that I found, but the thing is, it was all in Spanish because it was a Spanish big public case. So let's get into it. I'm gonna first tell you all the details, and then I'm gonna go in and say how I feel about all the people involved and what I feel like who is responsible. So the main person that started all of it, person that is most guilty in my point of view, is Sergio Andrade, and he was a big music producer. So he started off by trying to be a singer. That didn't really work out for him, so he went in producing music and managing lots of women. See, that's the key thing. He was focused on young Latin girls. So the first big public person he produced was Lucero, and he met her when she was just 13 years old and he was 26. So he was already a full young adult. He understood, and he came into this 13-year-old. The thing about Lucero was that her mom would actually go with her into all the music recording sessions and would not leave her by herself. But there was a rumor that they had a romantic relationship, so she stopped it. She canceled all ties with Sergio Andrade, and that's how Lucero was saved. Since that happened in like the 1980s, a long time has passed, like 30 years. So Lucero's older now, so they ask her in lots of different interviews if like anything really actually happened with her and Sergio Andrade. She says no, but like, does she really want to admit that she was involved romantically with a 26-year-old guy that has a horrible past? So do you really believe her? I mean, I personally, maybe nothing happened, maybe something was about to happen, but thank God her mom was there to save her. After Lucero, Sergio Andrade met Gloria Trevi around in 1980. So they had a contest, a lookalike contest for Lucero, and the person that actually won was Gloria Trevi. Based on this contest, in 1988, they formed a band, a girl band, and Gloria Trevi, so she won the contest at 15, right? And then a couple of years passed, 3 years passed, in 1988, that's when they formed a band called Boquitas Pintadas, Painted Mouths, and that's whenever a third person, there's lots of people involved, but the main three people were Sergio Andrade, Gloria Trevi, and Mary Boquitas. And Mary Boquitas was involved in that girl group, and that's how she came into the relationship with Gloria Trevi, Sergio Andrade, and all three of them were known to be the main ringleaders in the next part of their lives. So after Boquitas Pintadas, Gloria Trevi launched her solo career in the 1990s. That was the peak of her career. She was all over Latin America, and her appeal to young people, and basically young people, was that she was like very outrageous. She did crazy stunts. She was like the Lady Gaga, the Madonna of her time, but in Mexico, in Latin America. Just think about Lady Gaga or Madonna. Think about that in the 1980s, 1990s. So yeah, she was very controversial because there was nobody else that was like her during that time. And Maria Boquitas, she stayed with Gloria Trevi, but she was just a backup singer. She was not the main attraction. She was just Gloria Trevi's backup singer. So during this time, this is where the case starts to turn left. They start to recruit girls because they start a girls music school, and there, so they would go to different cities across Mexico, different states in Mexico, recruiting young girls. The younger the better. They would usually like 12 to 13 year old, and they would recruit slim, tall, long hair, and the key thing was poor backgrounds. If you fit all these three categories, you would automatically be invited by Maria Boquitas or Gloria Trevi to join this school. They would go to the young girls and the young girls' families and be like, hey, amazing opportunity. They're young, they're beautiful, they're talented. I really think they should come to this school, and this school will help them achieve their goals and dreams. Look at Gloria Trevi. Look at me. I'm living evidence that Sergio Andrade really produced me and really taught me how to be this awesome person. So at that time, those two women, they were like 21, 22, right? And they were recruiting these young girls. But here's where, so there was a school they were being taught, but it was more like a cult. They were known as a Trevi Andrade clan, Trevi Andrade cult. And while in the school, Sergio Andrade was like the ringleader. He was the main one, and he would force them to live with hunger. He would sleep deprive all the girls, and they even came to the point where they needed to steal blankets when they were traveling in different hotels. Like, it sounds fancy. Yeah, they were traveling in hotels, but they would be all crammed into, there was like multiple girls crammed into one hotel room, and Sergio Andrade was the one that says where each one slept and with who and where, on the floor, on the bed. He was a dictator, right? And whenever they would travel, this is where they would steal blankets. A girl said she would steal peanuts from the airplane because she never knew when her next meal would be. Sometimes he would starve them 2 or 3 days. They would actually have to steal soap and toilet paper because he gave them no money, even though they were sometimes earning money, because they were traveling the world with Gloria Trevi's fame, and some of them would actually be backup singers, but he would never give them money. He would hit them with the belt. Again, it was all mind control. So he wanted to control over them. Like, if you're weak because you're not eating, if you're weak because you're sleep deprived, then yeah, you would be willing to do anything, or you have no energy to do, you would just obey. And that's what Sergio Andrade wanted. And he was only basically managing Gloria Trevi. And with Gloria Trevi's money, in my opinion, like, I didn't really see or hear this, but I think he used her own money to buy different homes and scattered the girls. So he had girls all over in different houses, and in these houses he had them in bad living conditions. What I noticed was that most of the girls that were recruited, they would only stay around 2 years, and then somehow they would escape. I guess 2 years was their breaking point, and they were like, I don't want to live like this. I don't want to live in squalor anymore. I'm not going to become famous. And that's whenever they would decide to escape. Most of the houses didn't have drinking water or working restrooms, so they would have to go to the main house, which was known as the pink house, and that's where all the main three people lived. Sergio Andrade, Gloria Trevi, and Maria Boquitas. I think they were the three main people because, well, of course, Sergio Andrade was the one manipulating and ruling all over all the women in those living conditions, but Gloria Trevi was a second main person because she was obviously the one raking in the money. She was the one with the fame, and she's the one that was bringing in all the girls. And Maria Boquitas, well, she was the older one. I mean, they were managing young teenage girls, and she was already in her 20s, and she also already knew them for a very long time. And at one point, Maria Boquitas was actually married to Sergio Andrade. So yeah, they had a deep-seated relationship, so that's why they all got along. Another one of his tactics, he would force them to eat non-stop. And imagine, your stomach is shrunk down so much because no food is entering them, even no water is entering it. So when you're being forced to eat, you can't eat, and if you force yourself, you throw up. And he actually wanted to throw up them to throw up. He, after they would go and he would force them to eat, he would drive the car in zigzags, you know, so all the motion sickness can get you sick. And he trained them to spy and report on each other. So that being said, he did all these things just to mind control them because he had one thing on his mind, this disgusting old man, because at this time he was already like 40 years old. This 40 year old was forcing all these girls to be in his submission because he wanted to rape them. Right, that's right. All of this old sick man did all of this because he wanted to rape all these young women. And right before he started to rape them, he would force the girls to write letters confessing their love to him, and he used these letters to prove that it was not rape, that it was all sexual consent. Because, like, let's say they would go to court one day and he would say, no, she was in love with me. Look, here's a letter to prove that they were in love with me. They were all sexually consenting. Nobody was forced. Look, here's their own written handwriting. And these letters were really fake because Gloria Trevi or Maria Boquitas would coerce the girls to write the letters in the hopes of them becoming, again, rich and famous. If they really mess up one day or they disobey him, that's whenever they would get them to write the letters. There was multiple girls involved in this case, like 20 or more. Like, it was 10 years of this crime spree, and one of the girls that sticks out is Aline Hernandez, because I'm gonna get into her story because her story is important. So during the peak of Gloria Trevi's career in the 1990s, they meet this young 12 year old called Aline, and she was just 13 years old. And Maria Boquitas and Gloria Trevi recruited this 13 year old, and they went to her house, and they were like, talk to her parents, and they moved her from a different state to the pink house. So they met her at 13 years old, and a year passed, and then that's whenever she had sex with him with the first time. And again, he was already 34, and 1 year later they were married. So In 1991, I know she escapes, and 7 years pass after she escapes, and she wrote a book. It was called La Gloria por el Infierno, and basically, like, it was a book detailing all the sexual abuse that was going on in that group, and all the horrific things that Gloria Trevi was doing. And at 1998, Gloria Trevi was world famous, in the Latin, and everybody knew her, everyone knew her name. If you didn't like her, you at least knew about her. She was very publicly known. And so for this book to come out with shocking allegations, obviously, it was going to be tormental to her. And as soon as that book came out, for some reason, they say they weren't guilty, but they went on the run. They went to different countries. They were 30 years old whenever they went on the run. And they also went on the run because this other girl came forward, and Aline came out with the book, and this kind of motivated the parents of another young girl to actually file a police report. So at this time, nobody had filed any police reports, nobody had had the guts, nobody had had the money, because obviously they're living in a poor country, so nobody really has the power that Gloria Trevi had, because she had a bank, right? She had lots of money. These parents finally got upset with Gloria Trevi and Sergio Andrade because they were living in Mexico, and then in Brazil, they get a call from Brazil, from the country of Brazil. Somebody, a doctor, called them up and was like, hey, your daughter had a baby and the baby's here. They left the baby abandoned here at the hospital, malnourished. And yeah, your daughter was 14 years old when she became pregnant, and now she's 15 years old and she's nowhere to be found. So the parents went to Brazil, picked up her baby, the malnourished baby, and they're like, this kid looks exactly like Sergio Andrade, like, what the heck? And the sad part was that Karina Yapor, she was 12 years old whenever she was recruited to the cult by Gloria Trevi and Maria Boquitas. And at 12 years old, her parents entrusted these grown adult people, and I'm guessing they, first of all, they entrusted them because obviously they're poor and they want something better for their daughter. And if these world famous people are like, hey, your daughter has this amazing opportunity to come to the school to learn piano, then yeah, of course you would say yes. And so they let this 12-year-old go with this 25-year-old, 26-year-old responsible woman. And she looks responsible. She's tied to famous people that seem to have it together because they're worth billions of millions of dollars. But at the end of the day, when she was 15 years old, she was nowhere to be found. They went to pick up the kid. They tried to contact Karina. The parents tried to contact Karina, but nobody could get a hold of her. And that's whenever they were like, this is enough. She's a young 15-year-old. And we need to find her daughter. So they put in the police report, and that's what caused them to go on the run. So the book came out, the police report went in Chihuahua, and that's what caused Sergio Andrade, Maria Boquitas, and Gloria Trevi to go on the run. And this is where my opinion really changed, because at first I was younger whenever this case was in the media. Like, I wasn't even born when half of it started. What I remember was just like all the negative things, but after doing a lot of research, I really feel like Sergio Andrade manipulated Gloria Trevi into doing all these things, even though she was world famous, even though she was having sold out concerts all over the world. She was still being manipulated by this older man, music producer, and she didn't even have the money to do anything to escape, because he would take her paycheck. And sometimes all the girls, most of the girls, whenever they were reporting after they were gone and like after they were in jail, most of the girls said the same thing. Gloria Trevi would sleep on the floor. She was malnourished. He hit her. He punished her. She was basically like one of the girls, but the only difference was that she was actually bringing the paycheck, which is pretty sad. Like, this guy was really in their minds, manipulating them, that he could do all of these things. This guy, Sergio Andrade, he liked young women, and he impregnated a lot of young girls. Some two sisters actually had babies around the same time because he raped them. And whenever they were arrested, it was just known that he fathered 7 kids with girls between the ages of 12 to 14 years old. And there was more, obviously, that, but I didn't really get into like how many kids he had. But I know he also forced them to have abortions. It was publicly known that Gloria Trevi had a daughter with Sergio Andrade, and this daughter actually died before they were arrested. So this Gloria Trevi mega pop star had a daughter, and this daughter actually died. And if Karina Yapor's son was malnourished, imagine Gloria Trevi's daughter. They were all living in the same conditions. He treated all the girls the same. So even though Gloria Trevi was winning all these big paychecks, he still was not giving her any money. So obviously, I'm assuming the little girl was also malnourished. And when the baby girl died, they just took her away and disposed of her body. And Gloria Trevi actually didn't even know where her daughter was buried. And I feel like they went on the run because whenever they were in jail, Gloria Trevi was actually pregnant again by Sergio Andrade, and they had a kid, a little boy. And okay, so they were arrested. All of them three were arrested, and they were charged with kidnap, corruption, rape of a 12-year-old, which was Karina Yapur. And the two women, Gloria Trevi and Maria Boquitas, they spent 4.5 years in prison, and they were cleared. So when they were released from jail, they were cleared. They say they were innocent, the Mexican government. And then Gloria Trevi actually put in a big lawsuit against one of the major big Hispanic television shows, and she's still in battle with them. It's been like over 9 years, 10 years, and they're still trying to process that. And she's also in the same lawsuit. She accused a host to be giving false information to just collapse. The host was actually a part of a program for gossip, and Bati is her name, and she's this short, skinny, like annoying looking lady. And I'm sorry, but every time I look at her, I get annoyed just by it, because I've met women like her, and I don't know. Hopefully Gloria Trevi wins, because this is a multi-million dollar lawsuit. And after she was released from prison, she still gained her fame. Well, it took her some time, but people still loved her. Currently she still has concerts, she still makes music, she's still one of the high profile singers in Mexico. The other girl, Maria Boquitas, she tried to be in the fame, she tried to do music, she tried to do lots of things, but she did not climb the ladder, and she's known mainly because of the case, but she's not known for anything else. Let's just put it like that. Sergio Andrade was actually in prison for 7 years, and which is pretty sad, because he raped and had this cult of women, and he just had to serve 7 years, and then he was out of prison, and he's now still trying to make music, producing music. And it's just like a really sad case, because horrible case involving lots of different people, and it just goes to show you that money and power can get you lots of things. I'm going to include some of my other things that I've said in the other whenever I recorded previously, because I have different thoughts of current media, so I'm going to include that now.